Hubert Murray is an architect based in Cambridge, Massachusetts, who has taught and practiced in London and Nairobi before moving to the United States, where he has lived and worked for the past 30 years. Now that is the formal introduction, and that's what I know about him. But when I met him at the canteen today for a brief chat in the morning over a cup of chai, I felt that he has always been here. I don't know why. And so I look forward to this presentation, both for the insights it brings from someone practicing in a faraway land and the familiarity and resonance of someone close at heart. Hubert Murray.
Thank you. Thank you very much for that introduction. Now, I was lured into a trap, I have to say, by your Professor Chaya here, because when we were talking about a title for this talk, I had suggested Architectural Arpeggios. My wife advised me against it. Of course, Chaya encouraged me in my folly. And it seems that not many people know what an arpeggio is. So I have an assistant here who will explain what is an arpeggio, and I will then explain why it is the title of the talk. So just to begin, you must come up to the microphone. So this is like a pop performance. So ladies and gentlemen, first of all, we have the regular chromatic scale of 8 notes.
Sa re ga ma pa da ni sa, sa ni da pa ma ga ri sa.
Now, an arpeggio breaks that up into thirds, so that you take two or three steps at a time.
Re ga pa da pa ga, re ga pa da pa ga.
Wonderful. Thank you so much for that. So this, I can tell you that I'm most fortunate to have been saved by the bell, as it were, because if you had had to listen to my voice, it would have been not so clear. And I'll explain why this all happens later. First of all, this, I'm just going to tell you what I'm going to, according to George Bernard Shaw, who some of you may have heard of, when you give a talk, you have to say what it is you're going to say, say it, and then say what it is you just said. So this is the first part. First of all, a homage to Kurula Varkey, who taught here and who was a colleague of ours in Nairobi. Then a little bit just on what we did in Nairobi, and then a very quick tour through my portfolio, because you don't know who on earth I am, and by my works you shall know me, so I shall just give you a very quick tour of that. And then I will let you into two of my major preoccupations at the moment through two projects. And those two preoccupations are to do with scale, hence the allusion to the arpeggio, and change and how we respond to change. And then lastly, a subject which we discussed just the other night, which is what is to be done. This is actually a portrait of Professor Varkey from a trip we took in 1981, all together with Chaya and Kiran Pandya, for the full eclipse of the sun, a lunar eclipse of the sun. In a game park in Nairobi. And I thought that for those of you who knew Professor Varkey, and even those of you who don't, you know, here is an architect in the bush, still thinking hard and allowing himself to be informed by the events around him. So very quickly, this shows my trajectory from graduation in 1975 to today, 2015, 40 years later, and where I trained at the AA, taught for 7 years. I worked for 7 years in Nairobi, went back to London, And then, because my dear wife is from America, I was dragged kicking and screaming to the United States, the mothership in the Imperial Atlas. And we live in Boston and Cambridge, sandwiched between the two imperial superpowers, MIT and Harvard. These are some of the projects, and this is actually why I call it, again, the arpeggio, is that I'll show you some projects, but not all of them, so it's a broken scale. It's la, 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 la. So, first to Nairobi. When we were devising a new curriculum, Kurula Varkey arrived in 1977. And we had a sort of great stirring up of the curriculum, figuring out what to do. And he was an injection of incredible intellectual force. And when the dust settled and we figured out what it is we were all collectively going to do, we had to figure out who was going to undertake which responsibilities. Well, Varkey was the leader. So we assigned to him the first year, which is, of course, the most difficult year to teach, because this is the introduction to architecture, it's the introduction to first principles, and it's the beginning of an intellectual discipline that is the bedrock, the foundation for everything else that follows. And the rest of us took the easy bits, second, third, fourth, fifth year, etc., theses, with which you are all familiar. So, just to give you a flavor, this is, I think, you know, we can say somewhat Bauhaus influenced. This shot is from a publication which was called Build Kenya. And because it was so innovative and so successful, Build Kenya wanted to publish the results of the first year design studio. So this was an abstract exercise in spatial alphabets. They had a little design exercise of exhibition space, an exercise in anthropometrics, and then leading on to program and functional design around something else. And this was tied in intimately with Varkey's other courses, with which I was his sort of main colleague, later joined by Chaya, in which we were sort of mapping out the what the course should be. And so you see on the left-hand side, 3000 BC, starting with Egypt, and ending up on the right-hand side with Kenzo Tange and Chandigarh and all this sort of thing, and everything in between. And of course, with Varkey's sort of immaculate knowledge of all that, everything in between, and an orderly sense, here you see the way he would think. And it was actually a delight to prepare this, because I was delving through a box which I had somehow brought with me since those days. It's been with me for 40 years. And the mice, thank goodness, had not got at the paper yet. And there was an original Varkey staring me in the face. So we are lucky to see it. History and theory also was... The way history and theory was conjoined with the first year and subsequent year design practices was to actually go out and get out in the real world and to measure the real world. In this case, this fed into the history and theory course, which was to go out and measure the houses of Lamu, which is an Arab trading town, which was one of the stops in the trade in the Indian Ocean between the west coast of India and the east coast of Africa, and it has a lot of lovely Indo-Arab houses with Indo-Arab decorations and furniture and so on. And so this was Varkey's instructions to the students. There are many stories to be told about this, but I have to keep rushing along or we'll lose time. And then just from the individual housing measurements, that was expanded to the idea of the street and the idea of the neighborhood and documenting what is happening in the neighborhood. And this is an illustration which, I must say, must be a little bit familiar to you in terms of, you know, formal structures, the narrow streets and narrow alleyways off those streets. So I was 4 years in the university, so I overlapped 2 years with Varkey, and Chaya came on board. But I had just graduated. I was always feeling, as I was teaching, you know, I have not practiced. I need to actually be an architect. I'd done my year out during my AA career. But then I joined a practice, and I'd had the advantage of inviting various local architects in. So I chose my top architect, and amazingly enough, he hired me. And the first project that I was given was this big project, high-rise building for Barclays Bank. And I said to this man, I said, I don't think you've read my resume. You know, I have not built a building. He said, don't worry, you'll be fine. And so I took his word for it. He looked after us. And luckily, at the same time, Kiran Pandya was also hired to do the same job. So we collaborated together for another 4 years on this building, which was for Barclays Bank. And here, we started looking at the geometry of environmental control. And when people ask me, why did I become interested in sustainability, it was actually through practice in Kenya at the time, where imports were very, very expensive, carrying high import duties, operating things like air conditioning and elevators was very, very expensive. So you had to design as much as possible not to use all this imported material. You had to be as local as possible. And one of the things of being as local as possible is to reduce the thermal load on the building. The lucky thing about Nairobi, the Nairobi climate, is that there is a very low ambient air temperature. At the same time, there is a very high radiant heat. So the towers are split so as to maximize the shadowing at critical times of the year. So you see down in the bottom here, I think, we did shadow studies. And actually, this was a model built by Kiran. And held by me as he photographed it against a Nairobi sky, trying to illustrate where the sun would hit on these facades. So this was a great first training. We then went on to do various other buildings. I then went back to England, and this starts to be the very rushed biography. And you know, sure enough, in the place where I came from, in the north of England, in this town, a medieval town, 13th century town, one of my first jobs was to document, we were making a town plan. So I had to document the town in the way that we had documented Mombasa, in the way that we had documented Lamu, the very similar techniques that we had developed in the University of Nairobi were directly applicable to the north of England in terms of what was the historic role of the river crossing? Why was the town there in the first place at the confluence of two rivers? How did the market develop along the river banks and then the street? And then what develops outwards from that? And so 700 years later, thinking about what are the essential parts of the town to preserve, which is in a fairly dilapidated condition, and what can be relinquished as the non-essential parts. So we created a ring road, we created parking outside of the main center of the town, etc. And then, more or less at the same time, designing public housing in this northern rural area within the tradition of that northern rural area, but for obviously modern purposes. Likewise, back in London, one of my longer jobs was reconstructing a dilapidated Georgian square, which had been built in the times of the Napoleonic Wars at the beginning of the 19th century. And here was extensive reconstruction of extraordinarily dilapidated buildings, but an essential part of the urban fabric in that it formed one complete side to the square. So the preservation was not just to the individual units. There are only seven units. And these were being refurbished for, as it happens at the time, Bengali immigrants, people who had come to Britain as refugees from the war in Bengal. And, you know, there are lessons today, 30, 40 years later, that we might be thinking the same things and how to reconstruct parts of the city for the new wave of immigrants, particularly in Europe. But the greater point on the issue of scale is, as I say, not just reconstructing seven units, but reconstructing and reestablishing the urban discipline of the square, which was around here. Then on to Cambridge, Boston, Harvard, MIT, main part of Boston, Boston Harbor. This was in 1986, we came over. That is, just to give you a sense of scale, it's an, you know, just to repeat the theme, about 10 kilometers, about 6 miles. And I wanted to just show you where my studio is on this little spit of land. This is the Charles River coming out into the Boston Harbor. It used to be a free-flowing river, a tidal river, and all of these parts were flooded, typically at high tide. But with the construction of the dam, this is now all completely even, an even level river. And what was once marshland here, around here, this is a little bit of dry land, actually, historically. But all of this used to be marshland. All of this used to be marshland. So, and then I'm going to show you another project on one of the islands that I did more or less at the same time, around about 2003, 2004. And so this is my studio. This is the neighborhood, set out on a grid in the early 19th century, developed in the mid-19th century. So there was a 30-year gap between the layout and the parcelization and the actual buildings. This is the house we live in, and behind the house is a carriage house. Now, the economic reason, and this becomes an important point, the economic reason for the carriage house was it was the only way that the developer, the owner-developer of this house, could continue to earn a living. So he built himself a carriage house in order to conduct his milk business. So he distributed milk to the neighborhood. That was his main income, which gave him the opportunity to build this. He split the house, and so that's the carriage house, which was in the process of falling down when we bought it. And that's a 100 feet by 50 feet plot. That was a standard plot throughout the neighborhood. And there were restrictions on, that's the open space, basically. But then, in order to earn it again, to augment his income, he designed it so that this part was a separate unit, so that he could rent that out, get an income from the rent, get an income from his milk, and develop this. Once he had developed that, he went over the street and did exactly the same thing on a house just across the road. And so in order to reconstruct that dilapidated carriage house, I had to go in front of the historical commission. And everybody, all my architectural colleagues said, they'll never let you do it, they'll never let you tear it down, etc. Well, so I documented everything. I had to get signatures from 22 immediately abutting neighbors to say they didn't mind my doing this. The Historic Commission said, okay, you can do this so long as you retain the exact same footprint and the exact same height, the exact same profile, and then you can do what you like. And the critical reason, which turned them, was that this was the 20th century version of what the original development was about, which is I could continue my business as an architect by reconstructing this building in the same way that the original developer, the milkman, had sustained his business. And so this became a good reason for historical preservation. It's as much to do with the use as to do with the actual building itself. So they were not preserving the object. The object had to be demolished. But they were preserving the original purpose. So there's a ground floor studio, an upper floor studio. These are the service corps, the servant and the served, which you'll be familiar with from Louis Kahn. And here is the finished object with this, what we call the Juliet balcony. If you know Romeo and Juliet, Juliet looks down on Romeo and says her love stories. And here's the main studio down below. And then in terms of reinterpreting a vernacular, ventilated eaves along here with perforated aluminum, the idea, which also reflect down on the cedar, what are called clapboards. Everything is timber construction. The entire framing and the entire enclosure were made in 5 days by a crew based on the foundations. And then a little bit of mise on the corner. I always felt that the New England vernacular never quite worked. They had butt-jointed corner boards like this, which you could see from the old buildings. You know, old is not necessarily good. The wood would warp, and it would just twist up like this and let the rain in. And so I sketched out a mitered corner like that. And I showed it to the carpenter, and I had just a simple mitre, and they were just pegged on either side. And he said, just a minute. And he went out, and the following day he came back with a router which would allow the mitre to actually join together, so it could not be pulled apart. And even to this day, I mean, 12 years later, it is a completely fine edge. Just nothing has moved, and it's perfect. So these are stainless steel screws. There's a little sort of Mesian panelization along here. And a little bit of modernism with diamond plate aluminum treads on the staircase and light coming down the staircase. Unbrushed, unfinished steel, finished with beeswax on the sills. And some details of the steel work. So there it is in the summer with ventilation coming through. We get hot, humid summer. Not hot. I should remember who I'm talking to. 90 degrees, but very humid summers. And so there it is. Now, at the same time, I was doing this building for a school on one of the islands in the Boston Harbor. Now, with somewhat similar architectural restrictions in that this is part of the, it's a national trust, and so you're not allowed to change a thing, you're not allowed to add a thing, etc. So it was a major problem to get a new building built. They wanted an expedition center for sailing and mountaineering and so on. And this was historically, this actually had been an island for delinquent boys. And these were the buildings where the delinquents were placed. Those buildings had since been demolished. These were the boathouses which exist. And so So we were building a building which was, again, very similar, wood frame building in the side of the hill. We got our permits and everything. And down in the basement, you get all the changing rooms, etc., and then somewhere where you assemble all the expedition kit, and then upstairs, the classrooms and the major assembly halls for, you know, an event like this, let's say, with the circulation on the side here. This is the construction method. So as you're going into the hill, a waterproofed concrete masonry unit basement, and this would be waterproofed on the outside. Here's the elevator shaft. You have to have an elevator wherever there is any major change in level because of the universal access legislation. Anybody with any sort of a handicap which prevents them from getting up and down stairs must have access to an elevator. So that's, you know, that's $100,000 just by itself, but unavoidable since you have two levels. And then all of this is glue lam, laminated beam construction, and then you see the stick-built construction here. Workers were working on this in January 2004 when the wind chill factor in the Boston Harbor was minus 40 degrees. And who knows that minus 40 degrees is the same in Celsius as it is in Fahrenheit. It was bitterly cold, and there were Canadians working on this on the roof in those conditions. It was just absolutely astounding what they did. And so here you see similar details, and this was an innovation which the contractor didn't like, which was to put a little quarter of an inch breathing space behind the cedar boarding so that you've got a little bit of air circulation behind the boards so that in driving rain, when the building dried out, it would also dry out behind the wood as well as in front, and so therefore preserve its longevity. Cedar is the typical wood for this. Cedar tends to split, but it is also, it also has natural preservatives, so it's very resistant to rot and to insect attack. And then again, using this technique that I used on my own studio of giving a little bit of framing, a proportion, scale and proportion to what would otherwise be unrelieved horizontal bands. And, you know, the importance here of the details, and this is the balcony with a perforated aluminum fence. So that is not thin air. That is actually, you know, sort of small children cannot fall out. And so here are some examples. Now, so this is all small scale stuff. And I want to quickly sort of fast forward to 2011. That is a building which is recently finished. And I am not the architect. I am instead the client. And so I was actually asked by the Massachusetts General Hospital if I would help develop a program for a museum. This, in the United States, this was a first, that a hospital should want a standalone museum commemorating its own trajectory and the trajectory of medical science over the last 200 years. It had to be completed by 2011 because that would be the 200th anniversary of the founding of the hospital, the third oldest hospital in the United States. So my job was to develop the program by talking to all the medics and so on, but also to, they thought of it in historical terms. What have we achieved over the last 200 years? And I said, well, you know, this is going to be a boring museum if we keep to that. The point is that it has been 200 years of innovation, and the innovation has not stopped. So it has become the museum of medical history and innovation. And that has allowed the exhibits to expand. So, and then also my job to hire the architects, my job to, and the choice of architect is very important. We chose architects who were modernists, but also used to working in old towns. Such as Boston, and my job to negotiate with a very conservative senior medical establishment who thought that everything should be built in red brick with gables and, you know, the traditional stuff, and instead build something like what you're seeing. And the secret was in negotiation with the architect, choosing a traditional material which could be used in a modernist fashion, which did not have the baggage entailed by Boston Brick. And that secret material was copper. Copper is used throughout for various roofing materials and various styles, etc. But by choosing copper as the main theme, we got away with what I think you can say is a modernist building. And against the judgment of this senior medical establishment, they were harumphing every inch of the way. And now they are all very pleased with it. Then also my job to negotiate with the city about the degree of transparency, about leaving that little building there, which we really didn't want to have, but it had to remain there. So, and they wanted to see it through this glass, which is not great for a museum. And they wanted to see all this glass on street level so the pedestrians could see what was there. It happens to be a south face, and so the winter sun really penetrates there, which is a problem. But we got the building built, and we figured out how to deal with the sun, with blinds, and so on. So this is just to demonstrate to you that an architect can change his clothing and change his role, his or her role, sort of depending on circumstances. And so the architect as client can be as effective as the architect as designer. It's not only the person who sketches, who is critically important, but it's the person who demands that those sketches be done again. It's like it's being a bit like a teacher, actually. Respectfully working with the design crew. And so here is the upper floor of a lecture theater, the lower floor of the exhibit space. This is an exhibit of a touchscreen table showing the anatomy of a body and people learning from it, and then a roof garden, which where nurses can go on their hour off from to decompress. Okay, so that's all sort of small scale stuff. Then moving up to the large scale, the arpeggio at the top of the scale. Again, coming back to the importance of the street as the form, as the basic form for the development of university campuses. So I'm going to show you four university campuses with which I've been involved in teams, in my own practice. First of all, the American University in Cairo, which we won in international competition. The main theme here was the street. This is the street, and this is, you know, Cairo is a city not unlike the old city of Ahmedabad. Not unlike the old city of Mombasa, where, you know, it's a hot climate, it's a hot, dry climate, and the street is narrow and it's bustling and full of activity. And the secondary elements are the courtyards coming off of the street with occasional larger spaces where there's a big gathering happening around the library, for instance, or a major the administration here. And then similarly, in the University of Sarajevo, which was just a couple of years after that, same team, actually, too many details, same team, we developed this idea of a narrow streets linking a series of public spaces going out to a narrow street. And each one of these is departments or central core functions, often with their own private courtyard. So it is a semi-private space to that particular community, to the Department of Economics or the Department of Political Science or whatever, but the essential bit being the street. And the idea behind this was rebuilding the university after the Yugoslav War in the 1990s. In 2001, they had a competition, and again, we won this competition. And the university was scattered to the medical campus. This was where the site was, which was the old Austrian army barracks, because the Austro-Hungarian Empire spread east to control the Ottoman Empire. And this was sort of a big sort of battleground over the centuries. So the notion was that we took this, the old military barracks, and built this new campus around it. So having a historical analysis, a spatial analysis of the city was important in the development. Now, in contrast, and I'm flipping you around in time a bit, in my time in London, I had been part of a team with YRM, which is a bit, you know, a very sort of steel and glass type of firm. And they had a commission to build the Sultan Qaboos University in Oman. And this was very much a Beaux-Arts theory. That is an axial development with departments on either side. Because I was the only farmer's boy in the team, I was put in charge of the College of Agriculture. There were standard details throughout, et cetera, and my job was just to coordinate those standard details for my College of Agriculture, and somebody was doing the College of Medicine, and another one doing the College of Political Science, et cetera. But a very formal layout on a completely, on terra incognita. That is, it was semi-desert, just outside of the main conurbation. In contrast, take this, which, you know, which is, what is that, 14, 18 years later, which I was doing with my colleague, Ilhan Zebekolu. We went in for a competition in Abha, Saudi Arabia, which is on the west coast, it's on the Red Sea. And here we took as our fundamental precept the economy of scarce resources. And so we looked very carefully at the topography. This is the landscape. This is the landscape plan here. And so we took the high, we occupied the low ground, because with the low ground, you could gather any moisture that was around. And there is actually a fair amount of moisture on the west coast. And within the system, we developed a planting scheme which was like everybody's ideal bank balance, so that what you spend is also easily replenished by the income of moisture. And every building system was carefully accounted for so as not to waste resources. Very different from this attitude. I mean, this was formerly, I have to say, a very attractive set of buildings. But in terms of building systems and thinking through the systems and incorporating that to a certain extent, to a lesser extent, I think, that idea of the street with courtyard spaces coming off it, this was probably a more successful idea. So the two main themes, so that's a brief view of the sort of things I've been doing. the two main themes that I want to talk about are the powers of 10. Who here has heard of Charles and Ray Eames? Okay, a fair show of hands, that's good. This was a husband and wife architectural team in California. They were hired by IBM in the 70s. Ah, yeah, okay. I see, okay. Wonderful. So, okay, so there's, okay. So they were hired by IBM to make a film about the power of the computer. This was early 70s. And IBM at the time was Big Blue. It was, you know, the leader in computational development. And so they made a film, and this is my distillation of that film, which lasts for about 10 minutes, so I couldn't play it to you, which starts with a space of 1 meter by 1 meter, showing people, a young couple in a park on a blanket with a picnic, etc., enjoying themselves, 1 meter by 1 meter. And then they zoom out to 10 meters by 10 meters, to 100 meters by 100 meters, and so on, to 10 to the power of 24. And these are computationally assisted telescopy. These are the telescopes that are used to explore the universe. And so this is 100 million light years along each edge, all from that 1 meter by 1 meter, 10 to the 24th. Then the film zooms back down again to our young couple and looks at the hand. This is not 1 meter by 1 meter, but it's 10 centimeters by 10 centimeters. and then down to 1 centimeter by 1 centimeter, the skin of the hand, the texture of the hand, and then down and down and down to 10 to the minus 16, which is measured in angstroms. You'll have to look that up. I had to look it up. 0.0001 angstroms. That is, again, computer-assisted micrography. And so this, the Powers of 10 movie, was the most brilliant conception of how to understand scale as well as how to understand the power of computers. So that's my scale thing. Now, the other preoccupation I have is change. And I have to confess, this is not an original example. It was an example in my first year of my first week of the first year of architecture school at the AA in London in 1969. And we were shown a picture of the Cutty Sark, which was a famous clipper ship. You know, here she is in full sail. And she was launched in 1869. And obviously the person presenting, you know, was saying this is the 100th anniversary, etc. And here she is, the finest design, with the finest designers and the richest developers behind this. And the object of the Cutty Sark, the object of the Cutty Sark was to sustain a trade between Britain, the imperial power, and her colonial possessions, going around the Cape of Good Hope to India and to China and to Australia and so on. And going around the Cape of Good Hope was 2,300 miles, and going to Mumbai was another 7,200 miles. And they managed to, because of the very fine design of this sailing ship, they managed to take a few days off that sailing time, and time is money to these people who are putting money into this fine design. However, what no one was paying any attention to was at exactly the same time, and I mean within 5 days, 5 days ahead of that, the Suez Canal was opened. The Suez Canal was a complete change of technology. It was a paradigm change. The people designing, the people developing the Cutty Sark were not actually thinking of what was the real question. The real question was, how do we trade more efficiently between these distant parts of the world and make more money? They were thinking in terms of the object, which was the sailing ship, and making it as good as they could make it. And they made a very fine ship. But as soon as it was launched, it was out of date, because the steamships could come through here and chop not days, but weeks off the trip, so that trade immediately picked up and the clipper ships were left as what we call white elephants. So the rest of this, you know, part of the rest of this is we can be preoccupied with making our little cubes, our lovely little models, our fabulous objects, whatever they are, but let us be sure that we understand, and this comes to scale, that we zoom out and we understand what it is, what question it is we're trying to find the answer to. So an example of this is mass production. As far as Henry Ford was concerned, you could have any color so long as it was black. The producer was in charge. And you could either buy it or not buy it, your choice, right? But this is the way it is, a black Model T Ford. If you zoom forward 100 years, the consumer is in charge. The mountain bike was not an invention of IBM or any other big think tank or lab or anything. It was the invention of a bunch of people who had all sorts of wonky bikes and said, what we would like to do is ride the trails of California. And together they came up with the design for a mountain bike. Wikipedia is a perfect example. The Encyclopedia Britannica was the cathedral of knowledge. But then as soon as computers were, and so you had to accept, you know, the article written by some great guru, you know, wherever, the expert in some such subject, you know, that was the authority. However, Wikipedia turned it all upside down so that it democratized the accumulation of knowledge. And now it is reckoned that Wikipedia is more accurate in its entries on various subjects than the Encyclopedia Britannica. This is not universally true, I have found to my cost. But nevertheless, the point is made that suddenly the consumer is king, not the producer. So Henry Ford is history. And then Airbnb is the same. So that, you know, the regular resident, everybody knows Airbnb, right? Yeah, this is a big thing in Europe and America, at least. And so your house becomes the hotel. The hotel industry, the big centralized, the top of the pyramid in that whole so-called hospitality industry, they are deeply upset because their paradigm has been put on its head. And so if you actually want to go and visit, you know, if for work purposes, you want to go and visit a foreign town, you actually look first for Airbnb to see if there's a good place, you know, right next to where you want to go, where you want to be, and the hotels are left empty, or at least only semi-full. So, with scale and change in mind, I want to look at two of the other projects, two big projects that I was involved in. The first being the Central Artery Tunnel Project in Boston, whose complete length was, I mean, construction period was 1982 to 2006. It was a long time coming. The point of the project was, so in 1950s, President Eisenhower instituted the federal highway system in the United States. From his experience as a US general fighting World War II in Germany, he had realized that Hitler's scheme for developing roads, autobahns, right across Germany was a very smart thing to do. This was the height of the Cold War. Eisenhower says we've got to do the same thing for America. He developed an interstate system all across. And I-90, all the even numbers, by the way, go east-west. All the odd numbers go north-south. So it's a Cardus and Decumanus for America. So the I-90 went all the way and stopped just short of the center of Boston, leaving Logan Airport disconnected from the rest of the country. I-93 was the first of the interstates to be built. And so the bit that went through Boston was already dated, and urban thinking had already leapt ahead, and transportation thinking had already leapt ahead. So it was high time to change it. So there were various planning goals, which were, you know, you had to have comprehensive view of all the planning, and you had to have smart highways to increase capacity. This is computers again. And then you had to, by connecting the airport with the city, this is the continuation of I-90, you would regenerate a whole part of town, which was South Boston, and create prosperity for the city. The urban design goals, by burying the old interstate I-90, which was on this elevated highway here, you could reconnect the city with its waterfront, which was a sort of discarded piece of the city. It was, you know, smelly, it was full of rats and vermin and what have you, pretty nasty. And this, as I say, was connecting the airport with the hinterland. And then the architectural goals were what you would expect architectural goals to be. And these sketches, or this originally was a sketch on the back of a napkin. My job as chief architect was to assemble a crew of architects, urban designers, landscape architects. And here the best analogy is, you know, and this comes again to the role of the architect. I was not so much a player in the orchestra. Occasionally I played in the orchestra, but the 45 designers were the orchestra. My job as conductor was to think through what our job was and to do the conducting. And to be a good conductor, you have to be just one half beat ahead of the players. Because if you are just in line with the players, you're simply dancing to the music. If you're one half beat ahead, you're anticipating what the music will be. So this came out of a sketch, which is how to organize our thoughts around all the things we had to design. Viaducts, boat sections, which are the connections between the above ground and the below ground, the tunnels, then the buildings themselves, and the basic elements, the secondary elements, which are the details, and then third elements, which are texture and color and so on. And then thinking, A, you've got to create an environment for the motorist, which has to be standardized, uniform, safe, etc., traffic at high speed, and at the same time to create a legible environment for the city, which would accommodate to neighborhoods of quite a wide variety. And so here are examples of, you know, the highway architecture with the bridge designed by Christian Menn at ETH in Zurich, and the textures of the concrete boat sections. These are the ventilation buildings, breathing in and breathing out. That is their main function. And so the main architectural features were these vent stacks and the louvers taking the air down. These are the intake louvers, these are the exhaust stacks. This takes the air down into the tunnel, and on every building you would see similar details. These are the stacks. And so as people go around, they realize, they see this building, which is not populated, there's no explanation. They see, huh, I have seen that before. And they start connecting the dots, and they see that the tunnel, which is completely invisible, they start tracing in the what is visible in the city, these things. They see, ah, I see, this is a piece of invisible infrastructure made visible. And then this is the brains of the entire system. It controls all the traffic out to Route 128, which is about a 15-mile perimeter, 15-mile radius perimeter road, which is where all the high-tech industry is taking place. It controls all the traffic throughout the system. And these are the emergency stations with some bright, lively colors, some corrugated facade to liven it up a bit. You know, this is action stations. And then this is the workaday gas station in the maintenance areas. Here are the details. A very strongly rusticated concrete supporting the viaducts. Now, was this a good project? Did we really do what we had to do? And looking through the lens of scale, we did bury the highway. But what did we leave on top? How was the scar in the city to be resolved? So by that time, I had finished being chief architect. I set up my own practice. I was hired by what is best described as the Chamber of Commerce for Boston, the business people who had all their investments here. They said, okay, let us figure out what we want on top. And so this was one of the publicity posters for one of the meetings to discuss what types of activity, what types of open space should be left in that scar which runs through here. And so we had programmed a museum, a visual and performing arts center, an orientation and visitor service center, and then just intersected by five open space marketplace gardens, a harbor park, some other gardens along here, so that there was scale and variation all along the way. This is actually what happened. It's a long, continuous band of green, which follows exactly the line of the old highway. It is a visible scar in the city. And my view is that however much we dress it up, it is still a residual of that scar, and it does not reintroduce life into the city by itself. So all those lovely programmatic features that we dreamed up have not happened, except for a visitor's center, which is just here. So that got built. That was lovely. But there is work still to be done. So its potential partially realized at that grander scale of, you know, why are we doing this in the first place? The second test for scale is, did we do for South Boston, that area through which I-90 was coming, and we were supposed to connect it to the rest of the country, did we really work that out? The answer is no, we did not. Because the highway was being designed by the Federal Highway Authority and by the Massachusetts Highway Department. These are not city builders, they're highway builders. Then there was the city of Boston, which had no authority over this particular section of the great swath that was going through it. Then there was the Massachusetts Port Authority, which owned much of that waterfront land. They don't like to be told what to do by anybody, by the city of Boston, by the federal authorities, or anybody. So they are interested only in realizing the development potential of the land on which they are sitting. So nobody, there was no central authority to think through how you develop an infrastructure to make this a success. This is what it has become. This is a model, but it has become, you know, a little commercial enclave. The total land area of here is about 1,000 acres. It is very similar, both in size and in relation to the main city, which is here, to Hammarby Sjöstedt in Sweden, outside of Stockholm. And Hammarby Sjöstedt was built more or less at the same time. It is a new community of 30,000 people with mixed commercial, residential, industrial. It's built as a zero energy development. It is a fantastic success, and it's built with a proper green transportation infrastructure. This is a shame upon Boston. We have all the best universities, all the best thinkers, but we have no unifying politics, and that is a problem. Architects. And then the last few instances of scale is, which are still in the grinder, you know, 30 years later, is taking advantage of this big piece of infrastructure to unify the rail systems north and south, again taking advantage of this big piece of infrastructure to make a perimeter, a circumferential rail system instead of just radial, relieving pressure on the city. And the third bit, which is Boston is in severe danger of being swamped anyway. So all this huge investment, $24 billion worth of investment just in that highway, never mind all the property development and all the commercial activity, and Boston being a financial center for the whole of the United States, and Boston being the high-tech center for, you know, the eastern half of the United States, all of that is in danger unless we protect ourselves from Mother Nature. And does it, so that's the issue of scale. Then does it take account of paradigm change? Well, the fact is, it's a piece of infrastructure which can accommodate all these new forms of transportation. So whether it's Uber or Lyft or zip cars, you know, shared transportation, or any other form of transportation, yes, this is a good piece of infrastructure that will work. So it accommodates change. We cannot say that it anticipated change. Nobody knew that was coming. But it accommodates change. It will not be a white elephant in that sense. Second example is my work. Again, this is on the owner's side. So that was on the designer's side. This is on the owner's side, working for a large hospital system, Partners Healthcare, which includes Massachusetts General Hospital, Brigham and Women's Hospital, a whole series of hospitals in Massachusetts. And the reason I got involved in that is that I organized a couple of conferences in 2008 on the subject of cities and climate change. The architectural profession had been talking all the time about sustainable buildings, energy efficient buildings, this, that, and the other buildings, how green they could be, etc. And, you know, the LEED system was developed in development. And my feeling was that it's not enough to talk just about buildings. So it comes back to scale again, zooming out. we have to talk about the city, the region, the institutions, the systems that support each of these buildings. How can we make those sustainable? And so these are the flyers from Mass Impact. We got people from, we got Jaime Lerna from Brazil, we got the Deputy Mayor of London to talk about their program going on there, we got people from Germany, all over. It was a great couple of sessions. So Partners Healthcare said, would you like to come and work for us? So since it was the recession, 2008, and I was wondering what the hell I was going to do and how I was going to keep my office afloat, I thought, that's a good idea. So Partners Healthcare consists of about 16 hospitals altogether, 4 million outpatients, 150,000 inpatients per year. They have a gross revenue of nine to 10 billion per year. Over 16 million square feet of space. You know, just, it's a huge organization. And so the question is, you know, how do we make them sustainable? And so my job was to manage or to develop and manage a sustainability system. And so the agenda, which we worked out with an organization called the Healthier Hospital Initiative, which was other hospitals in the country trying to do the same thing, was to develop a leadership, make sure that our president was on board with this, develop a good food program, a lean energy program, reduce the waste. There's huge amounts of waste in hospitals. Hospitals, by the way, are the second most energy intensive use in the United States spectrum. You know, they consume, because they go 24 hours a day, 7 days a week. Chemicals, huge amounts of chemicals, including nuclear materials, and then smarter purchasing, so supply chain issues. I'm just going to concentrate on the energy issue here. We built, again, quite energy efficient building, and they all got their LEED silver or LEED gold designation. There's how many square feet do we got? I haven't got it here, but anyway, 2 million square feet. And these are the examples. And then I'm coming to this one, which was a rehabilitation facility, a completely new rehabilitation facility. And, you know, America had been at war in Afghanistan for a long time, and a lot of people, you know, with the improvement in medical care, it's not so many deaths that count. It's actually the number of seriously wounded people who need physical rehabilitation. And that was becoming part of the conversation in the country. So this site on the Boston Harbor, and I think I'll, but yeah, this gives you an idea. Here is the central city. And this was an old Navy Yard. And you'll find that in city development, you know, the railway stations in the 19th century were always built on the outskirts of where the city was, because that's where the available land was. Hospitals were always built on the outskirts of the city because nobody wanted to catch the disease, whatever was going on in the hospital. And in this case, the city, basically land in the city was too high priced for a hospital to pay. So Partners Healthcare paid for something which was right on the outside of the city, the edge of the city, on highly polluted land left over by the Navy, full of lead, full of all sorts of toxic chemicals. So we took it on and had to pay something like $20 million just to clean up the land. So that was number one. Number two was, we're right on the edge of the harbor here, and the that's the Atlantic Ocean, basically. This is the importance of asking the right question, because then the answers just fall into place. I wonder, this building is going to last how long? 80 years. Okay, what's going to happen in 80 years with this building being so close to the water? And we see that, I'll just go on to the next one. So we looked at the graphs which were coming out of the IPCC at the time, and we looked from 1950 to 2000 to 2500. Here's, we put 75-year life. We looked at, though the sea level was going to rise about 30 inches in the low estimate and about 60 inches in the high estimate. So we established a floor level as high as we could get, limited, of course, by access from an existing set of streets. Nothing we could do about that. So the building is situated at 30 inches above the 500-year flood level of today. Yeah, the 2013 500-year flood level. And it's also 42 inches above the 100-year flood level. So that should see us through the life of the building if nothing too terrible happens. Since then, the IPCC has actually upwardly revised its numbers. So we're probably going to be in trouble. And we had anticipated this. We thought, well, maybe we're not right, but we've done what we can. We looked back on all the hurricanes that had happened, mainly in the Gulf Coast, not on the Atlantic Coast, but particularly Hurricane Katrina, which had completely swamped New Orleans because of a failure of the levees. And we saw what had gone wrong with hospitals. One of the principal issues was that when all the systems failed, the air conditioning systems failed, all the power systems failed, and the windows were fixed windows. They were not operable. So just in order to breathe, and this was, you know, New Orleans is a very hot, steamy place, and patients were dying from suffocation. And so the staff had to go around smashing windows, and trying to smash a double thickness plate glass window is not easy, especially when the sea level is also coming up from below. And there were a number of fatalities, obviously whole communities were displaced. So one of the principal things, as well as raising the ground level, was to actually persuade the mechanical engineers, who are dead against this, they don't like open windows, say, we've got to have operable windows. And so the compromise was, okay, you can open the windows, but they must be keyed so that they are operable only in cases of emergency. So we spent extra money on that. But as subsequent events proved, you know, that was a very smart thing. All the critical patient programs are above the ground floor. So let's say we do get flooded, then no patients will suffer. And all the food services, everything, we have all services ready for at least 96 hours of supplies and food and what have you. All the mechanical and electrical services are put up on the roof. Again, this was huge institutional resistance. The utility supply company said, we've never done this before. We said, look down at the Gulf Coast. They do this all the time for exactly this reason. So eventually we prevailed upon them. And then the last thing we did was we got the landscape architects to think about how the landscape could be designed so as to break the force of the waves if the waves should come that high. And so there's a series of granite blocks and old timbers that were found on the Navy Yard site that are used as breakwaters, in effect. Now, just to come back to the design of the hospital, who knows about Aalto's Paimio Sanatorium? So here the notion is, and this is now well documented in the medical world, that actually giving a patient a decent view and giving and fresh air and natural light is a great curative contribution. And so here we were on the Boston Harbor, which, you know, on a fine day like this with ships going up and down is the most fantastic restorative. You know, people feel actually happy being in hospital. Look at that ship, and they sort of forget about the fact that they just had a leg amputation or, you know, something completely terrible. And this is what Aalto had in mind when he made the sanatorium basically into a sun machine for tuberculosis patients. And, you know, so here's a meeting room with those operable windows open because it's a lovely fresh day. And you get similar great views. And here is the building in its context, a modern building. But if we sort of again start looking out, Boston is already underwater. So we said, okay, very fine, we've built a nice new building, we've tried to do the best we can, and let's hope we survive for the next 75 or 80 years. But we'd better look at some other buildings that we have, and a big administration building, that's the one I'm just talking about, and then the big acute care hospital, which has over 1,000 beds, and it's got huge amounts of incredibly expensive machinery, fantastically expensive lab equipment, and this is the projection in 2100 for where Boston is going to be, the whole of the financial center underwater. So we thought, okay, we better look at all of this, and plotted a map from the U.S. Army Corps of Engineers, and so pinpoint all these little blue spots are the hospitals. These are our hospitals here, and that other hospital was here. Anyway, hospitals all over the place. What is at stake? Boston has about 4,500 acute care beds throughout. About half of those would be severely affected, just in themselves, just as buildings in themselves, would be severely affected if the floodwaters were to come that high. Because of the economics of healthcare, and I'll just get to that, the beds or the hospitals are 95% occupied. You lose money if you have an empty bed. You've got to keep the patients coming in. This is the way the economy works. Right, so the sicker the people are, the better for business, right? So if all the hospitals are full, because they have to be, and about 2,500 of these patients, let's say, roughly, or half of these patients, 2,250, are going to be displaced, where do you put those patients? They're all on life support systems, they're seriously sick people. So we have pointed out that the closest is about 100 miles away. There's one direction, another in the other direction, and still those hospitals out there do not have the capacity for over 2,000 patients. Even if they did have the capacity, how do you transport patients there? Do you transport them by railway lines? No, railways in America are not part of the infrastructure in any serious way. Do you take them there by private ambulance? Well, can you imagine how many private ambulances it would take to line up in the case of a disaster? New York showed us what a disaster that can be. So we are, and then the last thing is, which again, New York, the Hurricane Sandy, the tropical storm that happened there, is New York lost several billion dollars worth of research, medical research primarily, through the tropical storm. We, Boston, and Cambridge are the highest recipients of National Institute of Health funding in the entire country. They had $1.7 billion worth of funding in 2013. And that is a mainstay of not only the Boston economy, but the whole economy of Eastern Massachusetts, or actually New England. That's what the universities are about. They're producing scientists to work in the research labs, etc. So if those go down, the entire economy is screwed, and you have to start from square one. So it's not only the buildings, it's the infrastructure. So this is my initial diagram showing where the railway lines are, and the little circles are showing these are the stations which will get flooded. They will just act like drain holes, glug, 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 glug. The Atlantic Ocean will go down onto the red line, the green line, the blue line, and so on. And the seawalls have not been invested in for the last 50 years. So the red spots are the vulnerable areas. If those break, you get a far wider devastation. And all the roads which support employees getting to work, nurses getting to the hospitals, supply lines getting to the hospitals and wherever, all of those go down at the same time. Okay, that's one disaster scenario. The next not so disastrous scenario, and I'm conscious of my audience, is that Massachusetts will become like North Carolina, not politically, but climatically. I think politically we might still retain some measure of stability. But anyway, it's going to greatly increase the physiological problem. And I'd be interested, actually, if anybody has any observations about this. But in North America, it is generally accepted in the medical establishment that if you get a heat wave of 95 degrees Fahrenheit, which lasts longer than 5 days in a row, it is the old people and the very young who will be the fatalities. And it is more than flooding. Heat and extreme heat and extreme cold are the chief cause of fatalities in the US. So as a public health problem, climate change presents a major issue as well as flooding. And so we have to think, what does this imply in terms of the air conditioning systems that exist in hospitals, not only for people, but also for equipment? If the air conditioning systems are sized for the climate we have today, they are likely to break down, you know, if we keep the same standards, they are likely to break down in a heat wave which lasts 5 days or longer, because the chillers will be working just in overtime all the time, and they will break. So we have to revise the standards. So we've got a whole bunch of people working on revised codes in that way. We've got a team working on risk management. So we have heat waves, vector-borne diseases, which are not very common in New England, but will become more common. Blizzard, storm surge, flooding, I've talked about this, and sea level rise. And we look at what are the characteristics, you know, so let's say vector-borne disease, West Nile virus, Eastern equine encephalitis, etc. Who are the vulnerable populations? And what is the likely effect, the overload on the medical services? Then we look at risk. Risk is really an equation. It's an algorithm which balances the probability of something happening with the consequence of that thing happening. So you can have something which is highly probable. Let's say, you know, there's a rainstorm. But if the, you know, if there are good drains and everything and the water all drains away, you know, no consequence, no problem. But if on the other hand you have no drains, it's highly probable and high risk and a high consequence, then you've got a risk. So we have a team of statisticians, we have a team of climate scientists working on these algorithms for each one of our hospitals and the systems upon which we depend, figuring this out. And we are the first hospital system in the country to be doing this. So this is good. We're doing our homework. We're really taking this issue to scale from the individual building, which I described, up to the whole system on which we depend. However, is American healthcare has a real problem. And the chief problem is cost. And over the last 20 years, healthcare premiums have gone through the roof, and people's earnings and inflation rate is down, way down here. Healthcare is just completely out of control. If you look at it internationally, there are two axes here. One is life expectancy in years, and it goes from 65 to 85. And along the horizontal axis, you get health spending per capita. So I'm afraid to say, I'm embarrassed to say, that India spends nothing and gets nothing for its healthcare. You know, so low life expectancy, just 66, let's say, something like that. But you spend nothing on a national basis on healthcare. The USA spends a huge amount on healthcare, but the results are below most European countries and even some of the Asian countries like Korea, and actually almost entirely equal in terms of life expectancy and quality of life to Cuba. Cuba spends 5% of its gross domestic product on healthcare. Less than that. Cuba spends five of the per capita expenditure. It spends 5% of what the US spends per capita and has the same results. Why? Because they have a different model. So my question is, and you know, with all the precautions that we are taking, with all the risk management, with all the architectural design, are we still answering the question for healthcare in America? And the answer actually lies in getting rid of paper, going towards electronic records, going towards personal healthcare on the iPhone, going towards having chips embedded in your body so that you can be monitored remotely. This is one answer. This is the technical answer. This is the MIT answer. This is being developed at MIT. So you can sit at home and your blood pressure is being monitored and the acidity in your stomach or whatever it is being monitored. And you don't have to go to the hospital, you don't have to go to the clinic. Theoretically, this means healthcare costs come down. The more plausible side is that it actually does reduce dependency on hospitals, that the hospitals go away from these sort of rather massive, highly capital-intensive healthcare centers designed by architects who are making big fees and so on, and putting in huge amounts of equipment, and they go towards more intimate sort of storefront outfits like this little storefront, where you can go in and get your blood pressure checked or when you're doing your shopping or whatever, and then actually going back to your desktop and having your medical reports just brought to you at home so that you don't have to make unnecessary trips. And then an example of this is the Maggie centers, and I asked the other day who had heard of Charles Jenks. There was a good show of hands. Who's heard of Charles Jenks? Okay, the architectural historian. He was married to a woman called Maggie Keswick, who came from a very wealthy family. She unfortunately died of cancer, and she bequeathed her entire fortune to the development of cancer centers throughout the country, which would create a domestic environment easily accessible to people so that they would not feel institutionalized for the follow-up cancer care that they would need. So chemotherapy, some radiation therapy, clinical advice, etc., would take place in domestic residential style settings like this. And the trick came in, and this is where architects can make a difference, and I think it was a stroke of genius on the part of the both of them, Charles Jenks, and because Charles Jenks was so well known as an architectural historian and critic, he could invite Frank Gehry, Richard Rogers, Norman Foster, the whole bunch of them, to each one of them design a 5,000 square foot little clinic like this. This is Richard Rogers. That is Frank Gehry. That is the inside of this Richard Rogers. So each architect was designed to do for no fee just one of these little beauties, and the construction cost would be paid by the foundation. But it was a contribution by the profession and inspired, catalyzed by Maggie Keswick and Jenks. So last year, I'm way over time. So you've heard of Davos and the World Economic Forum, perhaps. You know, they decide what's good for us and what future we have to face. So every year, they come up with the global risk analysis. They ask all the members, all those high mucky mucks who go to Switzerland, to Davos, to discuss these things. And I think the net spreads wider. You know, what do you see as the greatest risks? And again, they have this probability versus consequence type of chart. And the greatest risk for this year, published only last week, is failure of climate change mitigation and adaptation. Now, think, oh boy, they've woken up. You know, Paris just happened. But, I just have to say that failure of urban planning, highly likely and very low consequence. I would disagree with them on that. But then we have extreme weather events, all these on the right-hand side are highly likely. Natural catastrophes, failure of national governance, man-made environmental catastrophes, all these are on the right-hand side of greater or lesser consequence. And then there are a series of urban issues. Large-scale involuntary migration, highly likely, high impact, right? And then, what is this, water crises. So migration, water, these types of things, these affect us. So I just remind you of the Cutty Sark and thinking outside of your screen and thinking about these larger issues which have been discussed in Paris and the issues of China and India versus the United States and the OECD, the European countries, the highly industrialized countries, and their immediate needs, and then our common needs. And I'm not going to dwell on the contraction and convergence, and maybe some of you are familiar with this, but if you're not familiar with it, just note down in your notebook contraction and convergence, and you can find out what it means and what that discussion means and how architects and urbanists can contribute to the resolution of that discussion. Similarly, the rate of consumption of our natural resources on the planet overall is we consume 30% more than the rate of replenishment of our overall natural resources. In the United States, we are consuming at 4.5 times the rate of our of replenishment. I made this slide actually for the benefit of the hospitals, and I pointed out my calculation was that hospitals are consuming natural resources at about 15 to 20 times the rate of replenishment. Not that hospitals can solve this problem by themselves, but it is to demonstrate that hospitals are major contributors to what is a generic problem. Costa Rica, by the way, is at the happy median of 1 to 1. We have the huge problems of urbanization, and this is where architects and urbanists come in. Because if the US is urbanizing, China is urbanizing, Southeast Asia is urbanizing, Brazil and South America urbanizing, everything is going up and up, where more than half the world is now in urban areas. These are where the solutions have to happen. How do they happen? In the current conditions, urban areas are probably the areas of highest income inequality. What other studies show is that in areas in countries where there is high income inequality, you get high delinquency rates and high social morbidity. So this is income inequality along the bottom, and then health and social problems along here. So better, worse. Now, the United States, I'm afraid, is another outlier. We have high income inequality in the United States, and we have very bad health and social outcomes, as measured by this paper. Whereas, you know, you really want to be somewhere like Japan, where you have low income inequality and pretty good health and social issues. And then the European countries are dotted around here. I think, you know, in the developing world, you know, this model falls to pieces. But the general precept in the developed countries is what counts. How does it matter to us architects? Is this relevant to us? Yes, it does. Because let us look in Boston. You know, and this is for young architects graduating, and I'm sure this applies in Ahmedabad. People graduate with an incredible amount of debt, you know, paid school fees and what have you, and you start off in a profession which does not pay well. In Boston, so this measures the percent of for sale homes affordable at median income. So that goes from 0 to 100%. Up on the vertical axis, we have income inequality. So the top four cities for income inequality are San Francisco, New York, Boston, and a certain town in Connecticut, unknown to including me. But Boston has, you know, a high unaffordability of housing. Now, it applies to architecture students, but it applies not only to students, but to people trying to hold down the jobs. The son of the policeman, the son of the son or daughter of the teacher, the next generation who are coming up, cannot afford to live in the neighborhood in which they grew up. They have to move somewhere else. this leads to social disruption. And so the importance of affordable housing is critical. And we are part of that solution. I want to leave you with a couple of questions. And this is a question from 100 years ago from a wild and radical communist. It was Victor Serge was somebody who never went to school because his parents, he was a Belgian, his parents regarded school as a bourgeois institution which would clutter his mind with all sorts of useless knowledge. He became the Minister of Education in the Russian Revolutionary Government after the revolution. He was an immensely well-read, an immensely intelligent, immensely cultured person, but he had found it all out on the street. He was a naturally intelligent person. So this is a quotation from his Memoirs of a Revolutionary, saying, what do you want to be? Architects. I'm paraphrasing this because, this is a direct quotation, but I've edited it. So he asks every profession, you've got to know what it is you want to achieve. Do you want to house the landlords in comfort? Look around you and examine your conscience. Do you not understand your duty is quite different? You've got to ally yourself with the exploited and to work for the destruction of an intolerable system. Now, this is revolutionary talk 100 years ago. We can compare this with the recent words of Vinnie Maas, who is MVRDV. You've probably heard of them. Great designers, wonderful people. So we're facing a crisis. He says we need to embrace this crisis as an agent for change. Disasters can be extremely useful. That's the thing about architects. They believe in construction, and therefore they're always about hope. Okay? We need to take that optimism and reclaim the future of our cities. I couldn't agree more. So there we are with our connected world. And this is Buckminster Fuller turning the world upside down so that we look at it in a new way. And I invite you to do the same. Just one last play on words here. You are nowhere. If you don't have any of these ideas, you are nowhere. But you can start here.
Or something that you'd like to comment on?
Hubert, thank you very much for showing us how carefully you've been working. But I have a little bit of a question. It started with the health service thing. And if I go up one or two scales, and maybe I find out that because the US is so systematized, people are prone to reduce the range of their ability to withstand change. And at that scale, like Gandhi took that scale, do you think that is something that might work more than the technological inputs? Just a doubt.
Did everybody hear the question? Because the US is so systematized, is this really the answer? And maybe a sort of Gandhian solution might be better.
Yeah. What I mean is that if one zooms out, then the total system needs
reform.
Reconsideration.
Okay. We have not rehearsed this, I promise. So it's a great question because about 2 weeks ago, there was a report in the New York Times saying that, and it has to be read in the American context, a report had been made that the average distance from home of the mother of the family, you can think of where your mothers are, the average distance in America is 18 miles. It varies very much depending on ethnicity and region. So if you are poor and black and in Mississippi, the average distance away from mother is 6 miles. It varies across the board. And it occurred to me, and working with some colleagues who were working in this NGO helping me develop some of this program, that this is the secret for healthcare, actually, is to work around the family network. And so that, and the secret, the point of this, or the relevance of this statistic, is that if with as the economy grows, and I think it's applying here as much as it does in the United States, which is you have to have two breadwinners in a standard family, because otherwise you can't pay the rent, you can't buy your house, or you can't send the kids to school, or whatever it is. But if both of you are working, who's keeping an eye on the kids? Mother, the grandmother. And so if the grandmother is close by, she can look after the kids. If the kid falls down or gets sick or whatever, the grandmother can look after it. Likewise, when everybody's growing up a little bit and grandmother gets sick, you're not too far away from her to look after her, to look in every day to, before you go to work, to make sure mother is okay. So 18 miles in American terms is not very far. And if you can build a preventive healthcare system around that extended family unit and develop an economy of healthcare from there, then you're, that's part of the solution. It's not a revolution. It's actually building on something which exists, but which just needs to be teased up and revealed a little bit more and made to work for the overall purpose. And I think that might answer your question. Yeah, yeah. There was someone over here.
About that museum, medical research museum you showed. How important is the program in the architectural practices there? Like, how often do they take an architect in the to develop a program for a building or?
Well, you know, typically a client for a museum is either already institutionally a museum and they want a new building. So the Whitney in New York, you know, knows exactly what it wants and it hires Renzo Piano. Or the Museum of Fine Arts in Boston knows exactly what it wants and it hires Norman Foster to carry out what they want. So it was, so it's a great question. So as it happens, as I said, a medical museum in a hospital was the first time this had been done. And the hospital had this general notion that they wanted to mark their 200th birthday with a museum, but they had no clue about how to do that. They know how to do operations, they know how to build medical buildings, but they didn't know anything about museums. So they hired me to help them figure that out. So I would say rare, but a nice lucky break. But actually, just to add to that, it is often the case that people who know most about their professions, let us say museums, or let us say any specialized profession, they think they know the answer, and they frame the answer in terms of all the things they know. But it is the job of an architect, so they hire an architect to go and carry, so it's the job of the architect to actually test the proposition. You know, because an architect is often told, we want a building of 50,000 square feet and it's got to have, let's say, 7 galleries and this gallery does this and that gallery does that and so on. It is the job of the architect in the initial stages to say, okay, let's just step back a few steps. What is the purpose here? You know, Cedric Price was the great believer in this. He was somebody who could break all the boundaries. He was a wonderful thinker in these terms. So, and he was capable of thinking in such a creative way that just reset the program for everybody. And the best example is, I don't know if, so Cedric Price was here, apparently. Not recently, but some years ago. So who's heard of Cedric Price? So he was Archigram is a well-known firm and all their stuff, you know, all the hijinks of Archigram. Actually, Cedric Price should take the credit for this type of thinking. And so he was thinking in the Britain of the 60s, there were two events happening, which in everybody's minds were two separate events. One was the whole national railway system was being closed down because of costs. And the second, apparently completely unrelated phenomenon, was that the post-World War II generation was growing up and wanting to go to university. And so there was a great expansion of the universities and being built at great expense. So the University of Sussex, the University of York, all over the country, universities were being built for hundreds of millions of pounds. So Cedric said, okay, let's take these two phenomena and think what they can do for each other. You can take an existing railway line going through an area of Britain which was has a big traditional working class in the Midlands, and we can make a university in the rolling stock, in the railway carriages. And you can have a department of sociology or you can have a department of engineering, doesn't matter. You just put the carriages on as they please. They're interchangeable. And you roll this all the way through and you can take a day trip or a week trip through the geography of the middle of the country. And you've got a university on wheels which costs you almost nothing, right? All you've got to do is pay the teachers. So that was called the Potteries Think Belt. It was a brilliant idea, and it never came to anything. Nothing actually ever happened, except it was the germ of the Open University, which was pre-computer, pre-internet, all that sort of stuff. It was the first open source, online university, certainly in Europe, and actually in America. I don't know about here, but it made it possible for people to be educated, to educate themselves at home through television, radio, etc. And it blossomed. So the idea of the virtual, because if you think we have to build a university, you have to ask the question, why are we building a university? What is the purpose of a university? Is it, is it just to get a degree, or is it something else? And what are the problems of people getting to university? Do they have the time? Do they have the income, etc.? And so it sort of breaks open that whole sort of that institutional structure, which Chaya was just talking about. And it breaks it open, and you see a new solution within the mess. So my answer to that very complex and relevant question is yes. exactly. There is no global generic answer, but the only answer is to ask the question you just asked, but to ask it in specific circumstances, because it actually changes for climatic reasons and oceanographic reasons that I'm not capable of repeating. But Boston is very different from Miami, for instance. Miami has a major problem with being submerged in the next 30 to 40 years. And at every high tide, Fort Lauderdale and South Beach in Miami are submerged. The streets are full of water, just in a normal high tide. But their problem is that they have a very porous ground condition. It's all built on coral limestone, and if they built a wall around their harbor, the water would just come up from underneath. You actually have the interesting sort of phenomenon of seeing beautiful green grass lawns and water just gradually rising out of the grass. It's not flooding out of, you know, the drains or anything like this. It's just coming up through the landform. So that they have their own unique problem. They have, you know, there are so many canals and bridges, you know, in the weaving together of the infrastructure, that if the sea level rises, big ships which come into Miami will no longer be able to get under those bridges. So what do? Raise the bridge? Or do you say, we actually have to shift the harbor somewhere else? Yes, smaller ships, whatever. And then the economy goes south because, you know, Kowloon has bigger harbor facilities. And then, you know, the Irrawaddy in wherever it is, in Thailand, Cambodia, is it? Irrawaddy? Yeah. Anyway. So each waterfront has its own problems. Boston's problem is that sea level rise is happening faster than anywhere else in the United States because of the certain currents in the North Atlantic. So it's a more immediate problem in those terms. But on the other hand, we have very good landform, and so barriers are a possible solution. But the Netherlands experience, you know, the Dutch have several hundred years of figuring this out. They created a whole set of dikes and polders behind the dikes, etc. And they are now beginning to think that that is not the solution. They have to make, you know, so they have a whole program now called Make Room for Water. So in the event of river flooding combined with sea level rise and ocean flooding, there are big reservoirs constructed to take the water. But, you know, accommodating the entire Atlantic Ocean is not a trivial task. So keep asking the question, but refine the question according to the place. It's the way to ask it.
Okay. Thank you, Hubert, for that wonderful journey that you took us through.
Sorry it took so long.
No, that's
fine. I didn't make the train run on time.
But that's fine. And thanks everyone for coming. We hope to see you again sometime.
I hope so.
Whenever you travel. Thank you.